Okay, now we're going to talk about War Party by Louis L'Amour as part of this unit. Now, this is a historical fiction short story. I did add some notes about the author Louis L'Amour, obviously a pen name, into your notes for this activity. But I wanted to kind of touch base with you about some of the ideas behind the short story. I absolutely love this short story, and I'm devastated that I'm not able to be there and teach it with you because of this stupid virus. But anyway, let's talk about it because at this point, I hope you listen to it. I know this scanned copy is not the absolute best, but you know what? When you're not allowed to get back into the school building, you do what you can do. Now, as we look at this short story, the main thing we're looking at here is character development and analyzing these characters and seeing pretty much how these characters play such a central role in this short story. Louis L'Amour wrote, gosh, I think over 80 books in his lifetime of 30 years of being a writer. Ask your grandparents or great grandparents about him because my grandfather loved reading Louis L'Amour. But this is just a short story. I'm thinking it may be part of a longer book somewhere. But the thing about Louis L'Amour is he's very easy to read. Now, we start this off, and as you can tell, it says, "We buried Paul on a side hill out west of camp, buried him high up so he could look down the trail he'd planned to travel. We piled the grave high with rocks because of the coyotes, and we dug the grave deep, and some of it I dug myself, and Mr. Sampson helped, and some of the others." This story is written from first person point of view from the character of Bud. He is a child in this story. And I believe he's probably 12 or 13 years old. Now, it begins with him describing the fact that his father has been killed, and if you read through the story, you learn that his father is killed in an Indian attack. And he begins to talk about his mother, who becomes the focal point of the story. Bud's mother is not like a typical woman during this time period. We're looking at probably sometime around the early 1850s on the wagon train. And most of the time, if you remember some of the things we've talked about in class, a woman had very little say, and most women were seen and not heard. Women did not have the right to vote. Women did not have the right to own property at this time. And so an outspoken woman was often looked down upon because most men, especially if they had felt in the past certain things about a woman's role, most men would not consider a woman's opinion. But as we start this story, we see Bud talking about his mother. Once she set her mind to something, she wasn't about to quit. And he talks about her and how she'd come through the Little Crow massacre in Minnesota and she knew what trouble was. But she asks her son, you know, we don't have anything to go back to. Most people who joined a wagon train, they sold everything that they had in order to outfit their wagon. And she basically says, you know, you're going to have to step up and be the man of the house at this point and help me. And of course, Bud, you know, he wants to help his mother. He wants to fulfill the dream that his father had for their family. Now, he talks about several things as he goes through the story. He talks about a group of people that were deciding to turn back. And look what he says. Four or five wagons were turning back, folks with their tails betwixt their legs, running for the shelter of towns where their own littleness wouldn't stand out so plain. A lot of people couldn't handle the difficulties that they would face on the wagon train going west. And a lot of people couldn't handle the fact that most people were considered to be equal out here. And so a lot of people decided to turn back because they didn't think they could make it. He goes on this part of the story to explain how some people, though, they changed for the better because not having people look down on them gave them the courage to be the men or women that they were destined to be. Now, something I want you to see here, all right? She said, "Paul was always strong, an independent man given to reading at night from one of the four or five books we had, to speaking up on matters of principle and to straight shooting with a rifle. Paw had fought the Comanche and lived with the Sioux, but he wasn't strong enough to last more than 2 days with a Kiowa arrow through his lung. But he died knowing Ma had stood by the rear wheel and shot the Kiowa whose arrow it was. So it's important to see here that their father was a very fair, intelligent man, speaking up on matters of principle, meaning what was right. But he also had a strong woman by his side. The fact that Ma killed the Indian who shot her husband, that shows that she's not afraid to do what needs to be done in order to survive. And so as she goes through the story, that's what they're talking about. Home is where we're going now, Ma said, and we'll know it when we find it. Now that Pa is gone, we'll have to build that home ourselves. She's strong. She's very stubborn in the fact that she wants to find this home and settle with her children. And the thing is that she has no intention of backing down. Now, as you go through the story, you begin to see some of the difficulties that Ma begins to face. First of all, you have Mr. Buchanan, who is another one of the lead characters. Mr. Buchanan is the one who set up the wagon train. And something to know about him is that he's probably very wealthy. He is probably getting a little bit of a kickback from setting this up. But he does not expect a woman to stand up to him, nor does he expect a woman to speak her mind and hold her ground. So Mr. Buchanan expects Ma immediately to turn around and go back because her husband has died. And he talks very plainly about, in the story, about the articles of travel. And it's in a footnote here. And the thing is, Ma, and this is what I love about this character, she's never ugly. She's never disrespectful. She's just very matter of fact. Now, you can see through these paragraphs that Ma is going to hold her ground, even when Mr. Buchanan tries to convince her to turn around. And Bud jumps in and says, you know, I can be the man of the house. But Mr. Buchanan did not like I said, Mr. Buchanan didn't know what to say, but a body could see he didn't like it. Nor did he like a woman who talked up to him the way that Ma did. And again, she's not talking to him in a disrespectful way. She's just refusing to cower based on what he expects of her as a woman. Now, Tryon Burt, as you learned in the story, he is the guide. Most of the time, the wagon train leader, like Mr. Buchanan, would hire a guide, someone who had been along the trail and could lead the group. Remember, there's safety in numbers, so the more people that they could convince to join this wagon train, the better they felt about their chances of safely arriving on the West Coast. Now, Mr. Burt, who, as you probably could tell in the story, believed that Ma was beautiful and had a little crush on her, he volunteered to help her out. But he also helped out with Bud. And when you get to this part of the story, he says, on the sixth day after Pa died, I killed a buffalo. See, that's significant. And this is one of the examples that I want to show you about how Ma is just an awesome character. So Bud shoots the buffalo, Try Burt brings him back and is all excited and tells Ma, and look at what Ma says. Why, Bud, that's wonderful. Her eyes started to dance with a kind of mischief in them, and she said, Bud, why don't you take a piece of that meat along to Mr. Buchanan and the others? Now, here's the thing. Is it polite to share your overabundance of food? Absolutely. But remember, this is the man who said that you wouldn't last because the kid couldn't do anything and you're just a woman. And so this is sort of her being polite, but also getting in a dig at Mr. Buchanan to show him they are more than capable of surviving in this wagon train without having her husband with them. And so even the other people began to see how important it is and how smart Ma is. Now, as the story continues, you go through, and a lot of the people are headed to California, and Ma very much, again, states her opinion that you don't have to go to California, that she just wants land. She wants a place to settle down with her family. And so they were worried about getting there and not getting caught in the mountains by the snows. So, of course, there's a little bit of bickering. The men are starting to listen to Ma a little bit, but overall, they still see her as just a woman. But what they're worried about is the fact that the Sioux Indians, this is their territory. And to understand what's going on with the Sioux, they are the most warlike tribe of Native Americans. And they kind of see the handwriting on the wall with what's going on with these settlers moving west. And they are very, very deadly. And so as they continue to talk, people begin to be worried that they won't make it through the mountains. People begin to be worried that they will run into the Native Americans. And so Ma, as you see in this section, she says very clearly, I'm not going to go back. I'm going to continue. And when Tryon Burt says, well, you'd go alone, she says, if necessary. Now, here you have a reference in the story to the Donner Party, and this is down here in your footnote. It says almost half of them died before help arrived. The reason that people are concerned, this doesn't tell you what happened to the Donner Party. They became cannibals. The ones who survived, they survived on the bodies of the ones who had died. And so that's why these people, and everybody knew this happened, that's why they're worried about getting through the mountains. Now, as the story continues, you can again see that there is some sort of confrontation, but again, Ma remains respectful, and people begin to see what's going on with her opinion, and they do listen to her. But unfortunately, people begin to say things that are ugly about Ma because, of course, when you don't like somebody, the first thing you want to do is spread nasty rumors about them. And I'm not going to go into detail, but no decent woman, that's what they were saying about Ma. Why was that guide always hanging around her and all those men? Well, the reason was is because she was smart and because she was a good cook, but that's not what they were alluding to. They were taking a jab at Ma. Well, the thing was is that when they saw that the Sioux had come by, Ma is smart and she recognizes this. But when they talk about there's barely time for a circle, the wagon train would circle for protection. But Tryon Burt, when he sees the Native Americans coming over the ridge, he is trying to give the people time to get ready, even though a lot of people would not survive if the Native Americans decided to attack. But the important thing I want to show you about this interaction is that Ma rode out there despite Mr. Buchanan trying to stop her. She took complete charge. She knew how to speak Sioux. The Native Americans listened to her. And if you look at that conversation and how she describes the relationship between her late husband and Gall, the Sioux warrior, she saves their lives. And if you continue to look at how the people treated her, it's like they don't even care. She saved all of them from being murdered by this group of Native Americans and their war party, and they don't give her any credit for that. And so you again see how the treatment of Ma is presented by all of these members, but how some people really see, her abilities and how capable she is of surviving. Now, once you get to the end, Mr. Buchanan, and some of the others believe that Ma was leading them into a trap. I mean, let's be honest, these people are idiots and they have no idea how Ma has saved them. But as you again look at how her character develops, she is never disrespectful, but she gets her point across. And here's one of my favorite parts. Mr. Buchanan says, "Put down that rifle, you young fool." And of course, Bud says, "Mr. Buchanan, I may be little and may be a fool, but this here rifle doesn't care who pulls its trigger." I love that line because he's going to stand up for his mother. Now, at the very end, you see how it's resolved, how Ma decides to go her own way, and how a group of the wagon train follow with her, and how at the very end, the resolution is that she finds what she's looking for, a place to settle with her children. But I want you to look at how much Ma means to this group of people and what a great character she is in this story.